Our solutions enable network teams to achieve operational and performance excellence to support the success of the business. With live action, network management teams are able to improve application performance, accelerate troubleshooting, manage network readiness, deliver major IT initiatives, and perform advanced reporting and analysis. On our panel today, we have members of Live Action's product and sales engineering teams. These are the people that are working hand in hand with customers every day to resolve the toughest network issues. We'll hear from Clark Zoller, product manager, and Keith Parsons, senior sales engineer here at Live Action. So welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us today. Clark and Keith, please go ahead and introduce yourselves and give us a bit of your background.
Hello, I'm Clark Zoller. I am a technical product manager here at Live Action. I focus on the LiveNX and LiveNA product sets. I've been at Live Action for over 7 years now. I've had roles as a sales engineer, as the advanced services manager, and now as a technical product manager. I've been in the weeds and been an engineer in my past life, so I have eaten the dog food of Live Action and LiveNX, and I can with confidence say that we have a superior solution to be able to understand what's the performance of the application, what's the performance of the network, and bridge those gaps so network engineers can quickly assess, is it the network, is it the application, and you can do your job more effectively. So thank you so much for being here.
Well, hi, I'm Keith Parsons. I'm a senior sales engineer with Live Action. I've actually been with the company since we were a DoD contractor, so about 11 years. My background is extensive in protocol analysis and monitoring. I was one of the original employees at Sniffer, which was the original protocol analysis tool. And I've also worked for several NetFlow products over the last years as developing NetFlow. So I'll be doing the demo for you today and glad to have you with us.
Thanks so much, Clark and Keith. So before we dive into our main topic of accelerated network troubleshooting, I just want to highlight some context and some of the macro trends that are impacting network operations teams today. So one overarching theme is that the network continues to increase in complexity. More and more businesses have a multi-cloud strategy, like around 93%. And SD-WAN is becoming pervasive and adoption is increasing, like around 94% within 2 years. And both of these factors only increase the complexity that network teams have to operate and support. And ultimately, network teams are just not keeping up. 73% of organizations are struggling to maintain the status quo rather than being able to future-proof their networks. So let's just take a closer look at the challenges with network troubleshooting. Networks are inherently complex, ensuring there are no simple answers to be found. An up-down status will not give you a full explanation of network or application performance problem. And there are multiple vendors across switching, routing, Wi-Fi, and network security with multiple network domains, including data centers, the cloud, local area networks, and wide area networks. And of course, massive scale with dependencies that grow exponentially. And data complexity is another challenge. Network managers collect and analyze a wide variety of data. Correlation of the data is essential to troubleshooting, but many network operations teams struggle to do this effectively. And tool sprawl. The typical IT organization uses 4 to 10 tools to monitor and troubleshoot the network, and network managers must correlate insights across all of these tools. So let me just give you a quick preview of the key use cases before Keith dives into the demo. So real-time applications such as voice and video are highly sensitive to network performance issues, such as latency, packet drops, and jitter. And chances are good that this problem is a network issue. And slow network is also a very common and vague complaint that requires a bottom-up investigation on the OSI model. Without a specific application to investigate, network managers will need an NPM that investigates broadly at layer one, but that also works its way up to layer 7. And SD-WAN solutions offer native visibility into the SD-WAN overlays, but their visibility into the WAN underlay is limited. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Keith for a deeper dive into a demo around these challenges and the key use cases.
Hopefully everybody can see my screen now. If not, let me know. So there's actually two views into LiveNX. So we have a web-based interface that can give us sites, devices, and interfaces, and overview with alerts and dashboards. And we also have our traditional engineering view to be able to work at an engineering level to monitor and analyze problems in the network. We'll start with the engineering view and go through it for a few minutes and then look into the web interface and how we can resolve problems very quickly. We're looking here at an MPLS network, and this MPLS network has several sites that we can see that are around the cloud. The routers and switches in the diagram are represented as circles, so a switch, router, firewall, packet shaper, wireless LAN controller will appear as a circle. Here's the data center in New York, and we have three devices that are in the data center, and I'm based out of Birmingham, and here is my Cisco device, or network device, and you can see it represented as a circle, and the smaller circles are the interfaces. So I can see inbound and outbound bandwidth measurements in real time, and the square around the arrow indicates that I have a QoS policy named shaping that I can analyze that policy and even control. Now, with the software we have installed in your network or an appliance, we actually go out and query the devices and learn them through SNMP, and then I can add the devices very, very easily. In some situations, such as within a Cisco environment, I can even push out the NetFlow template to enable NetFlow to be sent to me as a collector automatically. So when the device is added, I'm getting SNMP data, NetFlow data, I'm speaking to it via command line and via API in certain instances such as Viptela. So I'm bringing in that information instantly and very easily. If you can see the devices, notice that some are amber and some are green. The ones that are amber are generating alerts. The alerts are for QoS, flow, routing, IPSLA, and LAN, and you're receiving these alerts via email, SMTP, syslog, ServiceNow, so you're getting the actual alerts. And as you can see, interface down, class drops, application performance issues, media packet loss, so the ability for us to be able to see these alerts and be able to drop down to a report is very easily done. So you see, I can open a report from an alert and instantly have information here and in the web interface. So there's a lot of times where customers go, well, here's an alert, and I don't know where to begin to look for the problem. We prompt you with drill down and alerting that you'll see in both interfaces. Now, we see the devices that are amber that are experiencing problems in the network of interface drops, class drops, queue drops, or congestion. The question becomes, what traffic is flowing through them? And as you can see here in the example, the lines represent the applications by the chart on the lower left corner. So we can actually see those devices, and we can now see the path of traffic that is flowing through them. So web is green, and internet is red, and voice is yellow, and so we can see that flow of traffic. Now, I'm in Birmingham, as an example, and we want to look at the traffic for voice going to Birmingham. I can drill down and very instantly see the path of traffic through the network using flow. So I can see it all the way through, end to end, and see the performance, the metrics of the voice traffic, and notice there's an amber interface in the path. So we know we have a problem instantly we need to investigate, and also for my QoS people that are out there, look. we're going to look at the class markings, and sure enough, look at this example. Red is EF for priority voice, and we can see leaving the data center all the way to Birmingham, the traffic is marked correctly and is in the right class. But leaving Birmingham, the traffic is blue for best effort. It's in the same class as YouTube and Facebook, and that's not good for our voice traffic. Now, typical networks have a QoS policy here in Birmingham on this inbound interface marking the traffic to go through the network. We're very unique in the industry that we're the only platform that can analyze QoS and see at this level there's no policy at all that's on that interface. So no wonder we're not marking the traffic. There's no policy. Now, with LiveNX, as an exclusive look, we can create a policy from template. So one of the things that I can do still is that I can control quality of service. I could deploy a three-class template for voice or a four-class template with a scavenger class, 5-8 class model. So these templates are here for you to use or modify, or we can create one from scratch. Now, most of you have QoS, so look, I speak command line, and so I can go out and chat with the device and learn the policies that are on the device. Now, as an administrator, and I'm saying that again, as an administrator, I can select the policy, the interface I want to apply it to, and okay, and now I'm going to apply that policy to start marking the traffic. And what the DoD wanted 11 years ago was us to make sense of quality of service. And look, here's the policy I just applied, and look how simple it is to analyze rather than that complex command line. Here's the voice class, marking the traffic EF, matching on an ACL for voice and audio. The signaling CS3, matching on SIP. Critical data using NBAR matching on Office and Salesforce. So you see, classify, marking, queuing, police, shaping is all controlled through my great interface now. Even creating a policy for those of you who work with QoS, just for 1 minute, look, test. I created a policy. I'm going to add a class to the policy and use your voice class because it works fine and add it and see it, put in the ACL and everything. And so now I'm going to add a class to the policy. And let's say we're going to do Skype as an example. So if we created a class for Skype, look on the right. The red indicates that I have no match statement. You're not matching on anything. So here at the bottom of the screen, I can edit and I can match any way you can command line. ACL, name, number, DSCP, protocol using NBAR and the Cisco devices, network-based application recognition. So see, over 1,200 applications can be defined and analyzed. There's Skype, and just to show you, see, there it is, the policy I'm building in the background to be pushed to the device. Now, remember, you know, a CAT 6500 is not the same commands as an ISR 4K. We know those idiosyncrasies and send the correct commands. For you, it's the same interface regardless of the device. So we applied that policy, as you can see, and I want to show you back to flow the blue line, which was best effort. Let's hit refresh now and go out and look at the traffic and see what has occurred. The traffic's now marked correctly from Birmingham all the way to the data center. So now the traffic is in the right class of service in both directions, but we still have this interface that we're receiving alerts right now. So we already know that in the bottom right corner, we're dropping traffic in the voice class. That's why it's amber. And as you can see, here are the actual drops that are occurring in that class. Now, at the bottom of the screen, I also can show class drops as well for those of you who need to see them. Now, as we look, the top graph is for the gigabit Ethernet interface, a breakdown by application. So once again, I'm seeing all the applications using NBAR to be able to see deep packet inspection, to be able to see applications embedded in port 80 or port 443, et cetera, that I can see those applications in distinct detail. And look, Wikipedia, I mean, that's great detail to be able to see Salesforce Salesforce, WebEx app sharing that I'm doing, et cetera. At the bottom right is the policy. So this is a shaping policy that we have on this interface, and the voice is dropping traffic that we've seen at about 80K. So we see we still have an issue. Once again, as an administrator, I can adjust the QoS and look. See, here we are inside this policy for shaping, and here's the voice class. The queue setting is priority queuing, and we've reserved 8K. Now, we're dropping at 80K, so this is obviously wrong. Let's increase it to 90K. That should work. At the bottom of the screen, we have 7% of the bandwidth still available, so we didn't oversubscribe. Preview the CLI for change control and schedule it later if we need to, but I'm going to save to device to modify this policy instantly, and then once again, in the next couple of polling cycles, we'll see voice go back to its normal state. All of this is backed up in reports. So I have SNMP and NetFlow reports, and being able to look at bandwidth, utilization, pre- and post-policy comparisons, and drops as an example. If I want to look at drops that are occurring on the network, what I want you to really remember about the platform compared to other tools is look at the top of the screen. I never aggregate the data, so I can always drill down and be very granular. Some platforms will give you a 5, 10, or 15-minute spike, and see, I can drill down and be able to analyze, which is very important. So looking at interface bandwidth and drops, or class bandwidth or drops, 95th, 99th percentile, even CPU and memory, I'm doing all of this within the SNMP reports. If you notice in the lower right corner, voice is no longer amber. So let's go home and go to flow and look at this. Now through the network, now for voice, it's all green interfaces now. So no interface drops, class drops, queue drops, or congestion. And the traffic is red EF now in the both directions since we applied the policy. So now we've resolved two problems with voice over IP to Birmingham in a matter of seconds. So if you want to look at one conversation, multiple conversations, an application, a particular user, I have that capability. In this case, I'm keeping the information back in time for 120 days. This depends on disk space, on how long you want to keep the data that granular. So I can go back in time 120 days and look for problems that occurred. So a lot of you say, Keith, I don't know about a problem till it happened, you know, 3 days later they call and tell me there was a voice problem on the network. So, well, as an example, Bob just called from Seattle and said he's having problems with voice, and it was a couple of days ago. So in the upper left corner, look, flow.ip equal 192.168.100.11, and so I've actually put in his IP address, as we can see, and look, current time, let's go back to Sunday the 15th at 9:52 in the morning when he complained about his voice call 2 seconds after the minute. And I'm a refresh, and just think about this now. There are millions and millions and millions of conversations that have happened in the network since that time frame. I'm now going back in time, filtering through all those conversations and extracting the information that we need. At the bottom of the screen, you can see it was showing it was searching the actual data. Well, here we are looking at the problem for Bob, and let's take a look. Look out of the data center. It's red in both directions for EF the way it should be. But red is going into the cloud, and look, it's coming out blue best effort. The service provider has dropped our class markings for this voice traffic, and we can see it. very, very easily. So you see, it's happening back in time. Is it still happening today, current time, refresh? And now I can once again look and analyze to see if it's happening today, a week ago, 3 weeks ago. So this is the great capability of the platform, is once again, back in time as well as real time, we can analyze the traffic very, very easily. So, you know, this is something that we have worked on as an exclusive, you know, for over 11 years. And as you can see right now, the problem is still occurring. If I look at my data center router here in New York, where all the traffic's coming in, see, here's the traffic at the top of the screen in that flow format. So I can actually see those flows. I'm sorting by bit rate. So this is the busiest conversation going through the network. But look, there's Skype traffic and it's embedded in port 443. So instead of us calling that traffic SSL, we're calling it what it actually is, Skype, Google Docs, et cetera. And as we look through at the applications, we can see Outlook Web Service in port 443 or port 80 in your network as an example. So what this means ultimately is that I can actually provide very granular reports. And here we are looking at usage of this data center router by application. And the busiest application is SSH, then voice over IP, et cetera. Notice this is the SSL traffic, but we do something very unique. Clark and the team have actually created a unique flow template that we do that can do things that I don't see other vendors do. And as an example, look at this Symantec update here. This is an SSL application called by its common name. Other vendors I've seen who do NetFlow don't do this, but we do. And see, I can actually break out the common name for SSL applications. See, there's another one. Anything with a dot in the address is an SSL application that we're breaking out that normal NetFlow tools do not. So as we can look at the traffic and see there's the different traffic, the different applications, if I double click on voice over IP, I now look at all the conversations. So remember, I never aggregate data. So if you select a time frame, look at an application, here are the users. And look, the busiest user is between New York and Louisville. Due to, once again, Clark and their advancement that we do, we can detect the sites and apply the site names. So see the source and destination address. A lot of times I'll see this and go, I don't know who 101.11 and .12 are. Oh, it's from New York to Louisville. This one conversation, I want to show you that I can drill down and run one of over 125 different reports, but I want to show you the top analysis report. The raw flow. Remember, I don't aggregate the data. So here is that one voice call as an example. And look in the middle of the screen, the constant bit rate at 99 and 100K and the packet rate being consistent. That's a good looking voice call right there. Because if it varied in bit rate or packet rate, we know we have a problem. I can right mouse click and do the flow path analysis we've just been looking at to track that conversation through the network very, very easily. As we look once again at the application report, on the left, I can run a series of reports very easily. This is looking at the router by application. I can right mouse click, pivot to another report, and look at it by top conversations as an example. And so I can look at top conversations, or I could right mouse click and pivot again, and I want to see it by DSCP. So there, here it is now by class markings. I want to look at AF21 DSCP and drill down and look at just that class of service by what applications are running through AF21. And there they are. And look, there's that update as we spoke of earlier. If I double click, I can actually see who the conversation is that's experiencing the update right now. So once again, reporting, we have down pat very well to be able to run reports and analysis of finding problems in the network. Now, this is flow that you know of, basic flow. I want to show you that some devices, like Cisco's as an example, their routers and some of their switches as well, support advanced flow types. And so I'm going from basic flow to MediaNet Perfmon, and notice the flows at the top of the screen just changed. Where NetFlow looks at everything, a ping is a flow. Here, we're looking at just RTP, voice, and video traffic now. So as you can see, here's the traffic, and notice for the first time on the right, packet loss and jitter metrics of every voice video stream, you know, WebEx, teleconference, Cisco voice, Jabber. I've got it all now, and I'm analyzing that packet loss and jitter metrics for all that traffic coming into the data center right now. So I can go to reports and flow, and then very easily, as an example, go to voice and video performance and do jitter and loss, and look, here are my problem children right now with packet loss coming into the data center. Or maybe I would like to see this as jitter and take a look. Then I can look at it and see jitter. But you know, the problem's not occurring right now. The boss called and said that he came in on Sunday the 15th at 12 o'clock and had issues. So let's go back to that time frame and then take a look back on Sunday, and I have every single conversation. So never again do you say you don't know. You do know. I have every conversation going through your network for the last 120 days or further, and can do long-term trending and planning reports as well. So we have all the traffic to be able to be analyzed. But the flow type that I like the best out of the multiple flow types supported by us that's unique is AVC. So Cisco's been doing this for a few years now, and I want to show you that I like this ability of looking at application performance. We just got a call that Citrix is slow, and there's the Citrix application, and look to the right, AD is application delay, ND is network delay, CND is client, and SND is server. So now we can clearly tell that Citrix is having an application delay issue, not a network problem. So it's not my issue, it's an application delay issue. And I'll show you how we can drill down on it using packet analysis in just a second. But just from the routers and switches, I'm able to look at all those conversations now and run reports against application performance and where the problem lies very, very easily. So this is very cool to be able to have application performance metrics. It all kind of rolls up into the web interface. So the NOC engineer, the dashboard, the guy who's having the troubleshoot has the web interface. And if you can see, we're breaking things down, and we refresh this very quickly. So it renders very fast in large networks. I can see on sites that we're having an issue with Los Angeles. So I'm going to click on Los Angeles here, and we're going to drill down to Los Angeles. Now, Los Angeles could be a single site. It could be five sites. It could be 10 buildings, 30 routers, and 100 switches. I can group that and, once again, create sites or break them open as well to be able to analyze. So looking at Los Angeles, we can see there's two devices, three interfaces, 58 applications, and we've had over 6,000 alerts since we've been monitoring since the beginning. Look in the graph, and I have all the information you need for Los Angeles: application, service provider, bandwidth, and then also the application reports and also conversations as well. So all this information is provided for you. If I look at the applications as an example, and we look at the problem children, notice the red dots here on the left indicating the applications that are having trouble, see delay, network delay, etc. So if I click on SSL as an example, just to show you, for Los Angeles, see at the top of the screen, from that AVC flow that we do, we detected network delay and application delay instantly. So I know already that we've got a network delay issue with SSL. So you see, that easily I can resolve and render issues that are occurring. If we go back and take a look again at Los Angeles as a site and be able to look at applications, I want to show that there's voice over IP. If we select it, remember Perfbond MediaNet for voice traffic is showing us now at the upper left jitter and packet loss and all the pertinent information as well for voice over IP at Los Angeles. Look on the right, and here's the schematic, and the red arrow indicates the voice over IP traffic. I'm going to highlight it, and look, it's jitter and packet loss is occurring at this site. I want to see who's having packet loss, so I'll select packet loss, and there's one conversation, and there it is. See at the top of the box, the addresses, we're seeing jitter and packet loss. Show that to me in a path view. Now, I'm a NOC engineer, right? I receive the phone calls and I report the tickets and everything. So now I'm actually drilling down, and what we can actually see is that look at the example. Now, instead of me calling up someone and going, hey, we got voice problems, Los Angeles. I can go, look, we got voice problems, Los Angeles. But what is actually occurring is that we're seeing a little bit of jitter, which is turning into packet loss coming into Los Angeles. That's what I want my network engineer or my NOC guy to be able to tell me. Just don't tell me I got voice problems in Los Angeles. Be very specific, and I'm getting that. Now, in addition, everything that I've shown you so far is based off flow and from the router and switch. But we have a line of appliances that also export those advanced flows and do packet capture. So on the edge of the network, I can have this little unit spanned or tapped in line or the larger units in the data center to be able to capture and export flow. The reason I bring this up is that look here as we're looking at this flow through the network, you know, we can actually see the path that is going through. And over on Los Angeles, there's the live wire capturing this traffic as well. So NetFlow has detected a jitter problem. I'm going to click the live wire, and instantly we're going to be able to, as an administrator, log in because this, once again, is packet analysis, and look, I have preset a filter now for this one incident. In this case, it's jitter with voice over IP. I can now click start, and I can now extract those packets from the actual capture we have, and see, here is the actual packets now of that one voice over IP call. See, and with the event summary, we can see that jitter that was detected by NetFlow actually caused late arrival, low MAL score, one-way traffic, excessive packet loss. Show me where the MAL score failed in the packets, and there it is. So you see, once again now, the drill down of being able to go from flow to packet analysis now and be able to see where the problems are and have it in detail. We also have, this is live in XPeak, but there's also OmniPeak looking at the same trace as well. And if we look at this one, I can actually see the SIP messages as well. And look, I can even replay the audio.
Testing 1, 2, 3.
Having that deep packet analysis now gives us that ability of being able to, once again, give you the detail you need to be able to look at problems. And as we look at applications as an example, you know, with Expert, with the system itself, we can actually see the problems that we are detecting automatically. See the SQL Server slow response time, and then here are the conversations in the top that are experiencing slow response. So in the blue conversation, I can visualize it and see, I can see the flow of the conversation. And see right here, SQL Server slow response time, so we can see where the problem occurred and look. This is the actual payload that went toward the server that caused the slow response. So you look back earlier, we were able to use flow to detect a problem, and like jitter, you know, or et cetera. Or with Citrix, we were able to detect that the application was slow. The next thing that's going to be asked of you is, well, what's slow with the application? And we're able to do that with packet analysis as well. So this is where, you know, we're at today is flow, packet, SNMP. We bring in multiple sources of information to be able to monitor, you know, in the network very, very easily. And so that's something that we've worked on exclusively. With firewalls as an example, look, we support the firewall flow. So I actually can look at the flows coming in from a firewall and see the flows that are being denied and approved, et cetera. I can do the same with Palo Alto as well, which is another proprietary flow. And look, I can see the source and destination here in the upper left and the NAT translated over on the far right. And so I can see the NAT translation and run reports very easily. And I can see the username, see Manuel, what applications he's doing as well that are going or being not allowed through the firewall. So it is today about visibility, whether it's a router, the switch, the firewall, the wireless LAN controller. You know, we want to be able to bring in that information and be able to show it and be able to relate it to you for help in troubleshooting and analysis as well. Once again, through the web interface, you've got very many views. The dashboard is one of my favorites. So each of you that are on the call will have your own unique dashboard. So you can see the widgets that are here today right now that I can edit and remove and add widgets that I like as an example. So these are top sites by WAN. So the WAN circuits and then top interfaces and top devices that can all be drilled down to, but you can add your own widgets. So as an example, see here are all the widgets, but I want to do a custom widget. So as an example, I'm going to do a widget and I'm going to do application performance, top application performance, and I'm going to do it for Bob. So I can actually come down here and do flow.ip equal, and I can actually build, you see, a widget now just to monitor Bob. So I can monitor Bob, a department, a group, et cetera. But now I have that ability of being able to, you know, create that widget just to monitor Bob. And see here in the lower left corner, it will build that widget very easily to monitor performance when he comes back in online. So you see, this is the great ability of having multiple tabs and being able to see. Maybe I'm a voice over IP guy, I have a voice over IP dashboard. A server guy, then I can have it as well. Or I can build custom tabs. We bring in information from Gigamon Taps as an example, as a source of information. I can even bring in and create that in a custom tab as well. The geo topology allows us very quickly to see which sites are up and down, as we can see right now. And if I go to Los Angeles, you see here are those alerts that we can instantly drill down to and then be able to see those problems. So once again, all integrated into a single interface that we can look at today as well. There's the alert that I was looking for. So any questions on what I've shown today, just go ahead and submit the questions in the Q&A box, and we would be more than happy to answer them or show an example of what we can do within LiveNX to help monitor and analyze.
Thanks, Keith. We'll turn it over to Clark.
Yeah, so to continue on with what Keith said, all of this information is great, except how can it help our customers as well as yourselves make your lives easier? How can you use these solutions to be able to truly understand, is it the network? Is it the application? Well, one such customer that we've worked with, it's an international pharmaceutical. What they were really struggling with is understanding what's their application performance enterprise-wide. Also within their data center, they only had packet-based solutions. And so with LiveNX, what this gave them the ability to do is to be able to visually understand holistically across the network, what are the applications passing over it? What is the consumption of the bandwidth of those applications? And then most importantly, what is the performance of those applications? And by utilizing Flow when that's the most appropriate tool, or by using packets when that's the most appropriate tool, and then being able to operationalize those packets by bringing them into LiveNX, they could see hop by hop in the true path as well as performance of those apps across the network at each silo within that technology stack. The net result of all this is they were able to streamline their efficiency. So when they were troubleshooting problems, they were literally able to go from hours down to minutes to be able to easily and accurately validate where the hot spots, where the trouble spots, and then where appropriate to take remedial action. Thank you, Monique.
Thank you, Clark. So networks are inherently complex, which means that there are really no simple answers. Network managers collect and analyze a wide variety of data. A correlation of this data is essential to troubleshooting, but many network operations teams struggle to do this effectively. Consolidation and integration of tools is vital to network operations success. So how does Live Action help network teams? We provide visibility at all levels, and we consume more data at a more granular level than anyone. This allows you to start globally and then drill down to a location, a single hop, a packet, or even a phone number, all from a single pane of glass. Live Action provides end-to-end network visibility across the entire network, including campus, branch, data center, public cloud, WAN, SD-WAN, and we're vendor agnostic with the broadest support of key network vendors. And we also offer the broadest telemetry, including NetFlow, Packet, SNMP, API, IPFix. And we have an enterprise scale platform with real-time and historical monitoring without compromise. We offer unmatched data fidelity and the finest level of granularity with predictive analytics to proactively identify, troubleshoot, and resolve network performance issues leveraging ML and AI. So with that, I'm going to pause here and we'll take some questions. I see a number of questions have come in. I see Clark's been able to answer some of them, but we've got quite a few more. So here's one. How do you add endpoints like PCs and phones?
From within the interface, we have the ability of being able to add any device or endpoint. We show them when you click on the flow, if the endpoint isn't there, we will draw a box and put the IP address in. If you look at that IP address and go, oh, that's a server of interest for me, you can right mouse click and then select create network object, and then from the list you can pick it as a PC, server, phone, give a description, and then okay, and then it will appear in our topology map as that little device. So if I'm a guy who looks at server, I may have all my servers permanently added in there to be able to be seen, or my voice over IP wants his specific gateways, etc. So it is very easy to add endpoints into the topology map based off your preference of which ones you want to add.
And here's another one. This is a good one. Are there any information security use cases you can highlight with the solution?
Oh, yeah. We don't claim to be a security tool, but I do have all the conversations, which is beneficial. So being able to have all that traffic to be able to go back in time, and then I can replay it. I didn't show it, but I can replay the traffic as well to see denial of service attacks or things of that nature that are occurring. Also, several years ago, Clark and myself, we also looked at developing certain reports, and there are some reports that I can highlight within the product, such as destination address popularity and others that are security focused. So one of the reports lists user by number of connections. So why is Bob in accounts payable connecting to 1,000 IP addresses, and then I can analyze those 1,000 conversations to see if he's downloading, roaming servers, things of that nature. But the distinct advantage is that I am supplementing and having all the flows. Also, within Cisco StealthWatch is now the ability of being able to click on the peek button through a API edition, and Peak will launch our packet capture and show the packets. So for those of you who use StealthWatch, we have an integration that allows you to instantly drill down from flow to packet analysis with our LiveWire devices as well.
Thank you. Here's another question. What's the difference between using the software client and the web client? Can't you only work with the web client?
Yes, that is a true answer, that I can, as I've shown in the demonstration, can do everything virtually from the web interface. There are a few things that I do like to use the client for visibility, but I do want to stress that Clark and the team have made significant strides to bring over, a lot of the functionality out of the client into the web interface. The QoS configuration piece that I was showing earlier in the client is still not in the web interface, so that's why I was demonstrating it with the client. But yes, as you've seen earlier, I'm able to drill down, pick a conversation, look at that, it had jitter, and then analyze it at the packet level. So the web interface works well. And the last thing I'll add is that I have a Cisco AnyConnect on my Android phone. I can actually do a VPN connection to Live Action, launch Live NX, drill down to a packet capture all on my cell phone. And I think that's pretty cool.
That is cool, Keith. I like that. So here, I think we have time for maybe one or two more questions. Got one here. Is there documentation on setting up email alerts within the Live Action dashboard?
Yes. The guide is there in the client. There's the complete user guide as well. And then I can provide the information on how to set this information up within the web interface as well.
All right, and one more question here. Is there any specific config that must be enabled to use MediaNet and AVC flow? My routers now are only showing data on basic flows.
Yes, Clark and his team have created some great templates that we use. So much as there's a standard NetFlow template that's used to get NetFlow, there's a template for PerfMon and AVC. Some use a unified template that we provide that provides both. But within Live NX, you can actually go to flow configuration, and we will prompt you what type of template would you like to push. Standard flexible flow, AVC, or MediaNet, and we will build that template for you. Please be aware that on the platform, you do need to have a license. On the ISR 4Ks, the application experience license is pretty much on every ISR 4K. On your older devices, the app, the K9 license is required. On the ASRs, most of them have the license already enabled. As well.